Fair to say that right now I feel like I am on a very, very, very steep learning curve indeed. In fact, it's been 3.5, going on 4 now, years since I've been reading scripture, and I don't think I've ever been as excited as I am now, which stands to reason because the further you go, the more exciting it gets. And I've found over the last 3.5, 4 years since I've started doing this, that it comes in spurts. I know around the time I got sick, a few weeks ago, I was really, really flat in Jeremiah. I had about 3 or 4 days where I just felt I was learning nothing every day in those scriptures. And I was really starting to wonder what was going on. And then I got to that last 28 pages, those last amazing 28 pages of that Old Testament, and it all just started again. In fact, when I finish this read in a few days, I'm thinking that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to read Isaiah. So I got a lot out of Isaiah this time. Read Isaiah, then Jeremiah again, and then I'm thinking another New Testament read. But I found over the period that it comes in spurts. You just have these learnings in spurts and then it stops. It's always coming in. You're always learning new things. You're always learning more about the knowledge and the mystery of God. The mystery is revealed, right? And the perfect knowledge of his will. But it tends to come in real spurts. And that's what I'm finding is happening now. And now that I'm seeing the things that I've been seeing about the body of Christ in particular, becoming one with God, that being the house of the Lord, Jerusalem, I'm just now seeing more and more in those scriptures, and just every scripture just seems now to be, they've always been full of life, but now I'm seeing just how and why, just more and more and more. So yeah, it's getting exciting. I'm very excited, very, very exciting. Lots of weird stuff going on in my life, and that's crucial, isn't it? That's crucial that we stay abased. I'll get to that in just a sec. It's a beautiful, beautiful It's late winter now, late winter's morning here on the New South Wales Central Coast. It is Wednesday. It's a Wednesday morning. It's about 7:30 in the morning, and it's the 27th of July, and I can do this, am up to 1 Timothy 5, just over there. My hands aren't doing anything suspect, I hope. No, that's all good. 1 Timothy 5, and it's been a big few days in the scriptures, and given it's an absolutely beautiful morning here, and I've got a lot more coming in, I thought, why not? Why not take this opportunity to head back down onto the into the park, right? Now, I want to start today with the big calendar. This one, wowee. Some days I feel as though the Lord Jesus Christ is just standing right there when I receive those calendar verses. And I got this big one today. In Isaiah 30, 21. And thine ears shall hear a word behind thee, right? Like, check this out. And thine ears shall hear a word behind thee. So we hear the word of God by testimony and through scripture, saying, this is the way. Now that would be H 1870, I would think. Walk ye in it when ye turn to the right hand and when ye turn to the left. The voice, right? The voice, the word of God behind thee. And he's going to show us the H1870 way, right? Yes. All right. I got this is what I say. That one this morning, I felt the Lord Jesus Christ was right there delivering that to me this morning. Now there's quite a bit here as usual I want to go through, and I'm going to start out today just I'm going to share a news story that goes to one of my infirmities, right, that I've spoken about before quite a bit recently, because I see people that share this affliction that I've got being used in a very, very evil, cunning, deceptive and destructive way at the moment. And there's a furor that I've seen in the news here that's just come through, and I want to speak out about it today. And I also want to share, yeah, it's a testimony of sorts, just a comment that I shared that I received on my BitChute video. So I upload all my videos to BitChute as well as YouTube. And just a comment that I received on BitChute. I want to share that comment, my thoughts, and ask you to consider it and potentially give your thoughts if you so feel led. Now, Paul tells us, doesn't he? Paul tells us that we must glorify. Now, is that going to bit down there? That's it, right? Is that it? I reckon that's it. Paul tells us to glorify in our infirmities, because while we're doing that, it keeps us abased. And for me, it's become more and more critical now. I understand it more and more, just how critical it is for us to stay abased. As our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, we share in his suffering so that we may be glorified together. What does that mean? Glorified together. And that's in part, that's the plan, that's the main part of what I want to talk about today. Just being glorified together with the Lord Jesus Christ as we become one with one another, as we become one with the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father, who are one, right? So this is what I want to talk about today. Now, this story is quite incredible. So there's a rugby league here in Australia. There's two main codes of football. There's the rugby league that's played mainly in the northern states, and then you've got the AFL that's played all over, but it's bigger in the southern states. And that's the game I used to watch. The one I'm talking about today, I grew up with it. Now, why I wore this beanie, it never sits on my head right. But the one I'm talking about today, I grew up with it, but I veered away from it when I was in my mid-20s, and I started watching the AFL, and that the AFL was the one that I ended up really enjoying, and now I watch neither. But I'm finding that I'm just keeping an eye on events right now, because I want to know what the agendas are, and I want to know what they're doing just to try to discern what's happening so we can make the appropriate steps. And this story came through. It says, so I'll just read the headline. Three Manly Sea Eagles. So it's so funny, right? This club's name's Manly, right? M-A-N-L-Y, Manly, right? So it's manly, it's not womanly, it's not personally, it's manly, right? So this is all part of it, I feel, with their agenda with this. Three Manly Sea Eagles will reportedly reconsider wearing pride jersey for crucial Sydney Roosters NRL match. So what's going on? And all of those players, what I can see, the majority of them, I think they might be Pacific Islanders who are very, they appear to be very cultural and potentially spiritual people. I don't know about their faith and I'm not going to comment on that today. And I'm not going to go there as to whether these players are actually part of the agenda or not. I'm not going to go there. Because I don't know. I don't know a lot about it. But the coach has most certainly told me he's part in it, right? So what's happened is that they call it inclusiveness. Inclusiveness now, and diversity. They're their two words. So what they're doing, and I've spoken on this previously, that over the last 10 years, women have just been overtaking everything in society. It's about, you can't get equality. And please, sisters, it's, you know me by now, and you know the agendas by now. And this is what I'm talking about today, the agenda that they use people with my affliction. And they're using the ladies just the same. How women are just, you can't have equality. And it's like Aboriginal people here in Australia, you can't have equality unless Aboriginal people are advantaged and they get advantage, and there's discrimination to Aboriginal people for white people and every other people, every other race here in Australia. That's equality with Aboriginals, right? And it's the same with women. Women have to be selected in jobs because they're women, so we can have equality with men. And it's right through society. And I've been finding, and I did this when I was at Telstra, I asked a whole heap of the girls, have you ever been disadvantaged, or have you ever had different pay because you're a woman ever in the workplace? And every single one of those girls went, no. I'm like, well, what's the problem? Because it's blatant discrimination. You take them to court, right? You can take them to court, as can a lot of people for what they're doing here with this jersey. So women have been taking over every aspect pretty well of society here in Australia for about 2 years, and I've just been watching it. But I've got my calendars all in order here, and because these park videos can be very, very difficult to put down, and the wind just blew them everywhere, and now they're all out of order, and so now I know I've got a struggle ahead of me, right? Anyway, for inclusiveness and diversity, they've got a women in league round going on. So they've been ramming it down our throat. You have to like it. You can't not like it. Because if you don't like it, if you sit out a Saturday afternoon to watch the football as I used to, don't want to hear a woman commentating. I don't want to see women, and I don't want to see women in the change rooms. It's a bastion for men. Women can absolutely get involved. They can go and watch the game like the rest of us can. But it's a game for men. If women want to play, they can go and play. But this is a game for men, and it's a bastion of men. Just like women have their own bastions, men are allowed to have their own bastions, but they can't, because that wouldn't be equality, because women aren't advantaged, right? So they've got a women, inclusive women in league round, right? And you have to like it. And I've known rugby league, it's like the caveman code. I've known a lot of rugby league players in my time, and rugby league players would not be approving of having a women in league round, I can tell you that much. And also this one here. So as a part of women in league round, it's like here at the moment, they're discussing a religious discrimination bill and in Parliament. And every time I look at it, it pertains to transgender people. I can't make the connection. It's just so weird. But they're addressing the religious problem, right? They're addressing the religious problem, and they're doing it here as well. So what's happened is a part of women in league round, the Manly, M-A-N-L-Y, the Manly Sea Eagles are going to wear a gay pride jersey. as a part of Women in Leaground for inclusion and diversity, right? And I am suspecting that as a part of this inclusiveness and diversity, I can't imagine there's going to be around at all anywhere that says that there's only two sexes, male and female, and if you say anything else, well then you're excluding the body of Christ, right? No. It's all rubbish, right? But what they're doing here, you've got seven of these players who have, they're forfeiting the game. They're not going to play in protest because it goes against their religious and their spiritual beliefs. So here right now, that's what's happening. It's a war. It's starting to descend now into a war between gay people and religion. And the religion they're talking about, and I'm not talking about the players, they could just be pawns in this game, but the religion is it's religion. It's got nothing to do with the body of Christ, right? And I have this affliction, and here we go, right? Here we go. We need to, I'll put him up on screen now. This is the coach. This is the Manly, M-A-N-L-Y coach, right? It's not personally, it's not womanly, it's the Manly coach. It's got to be part of it, right? Why this club? Why this club? But it's blown up. It's absolutely blown up in their faces because these players have just said, no, we're not going to play because it goes against our spiritual and cultural beliefs. And this is the Manly coach. I reckon he spent, this is a 10-minute address. I watched it yesterday. I reckon he spent more time doing Masonic hand signs in this address to the media. I thought he was doing more. I reckon he was doing Masonic hand signs more than what he wasn't. Like, check him out. So it's Masonic, right? It's Masonic. The whole thing is Masonic, and this guy, just because he's given it away, he's just given up the game. So the whole thing, we knew it, but this is a critical part of testimony. Of testimony. I remember when I first started waking up that one thing after another. And first up, I'd be like, I remember the day I learned the Beatles were Freemasons and they were satanic and they evil, they just fed a whole generation full of just evil, vile evil. I didn't want to hear it. I didn't want to hear it, you know, and you don't hearken at first, but it took a few days and then you come and then you hearken, right? And it's all just a critical part of your testimony. And I remember that day on my brother's lounge, I'll never forget it, about 3 years ago, it was around the time I stopped drinking, where it just unraveled. It was just a Saturday afternoon where all I could see was Masonic hand signs. And it's just a critical part of your testimony, and you hearken. He goes, not that I needed to, but for me it was a confirmation. You get to a point where you've hearkened so much, it's a confirmation. So this whole thing is Masonic. So I see now that they're pitting, and they're going to make it worse. They're going to make it worse for somebody like me. For somebody like me now, I don't know anybody else who loves the Lord Jesus Christ with a sincere heart that has this affliction. I don't know anyone. I'm not saying there's none. I've just never heard of it. There's people who claim to be Christians and go to church because they're just pushing their agenda. But this is game on for me, right? I really feel as though I'm coming into, I'm going to be very, very strong. I have to be a very, very strong soldier in Christ because this is going to get, it's going to get very, very difficult. Very difficult indeed to navigate this because you've got religion and gay, transgender and all this LGBTQ nonsense. You've got that now pitted against religion. The two are pitted against each other. It's just, wowee, right? Wowee. So it's like, strap yourself in, Brett. Here we go. Here we go. Whole thing's Masonic from top to bottom. The whole thing was a preconceived Masonic agenda, and they're using these people as pawns in their game. People like me who have got this affliction, and I, of course, ain't a part of any of it. And it's just a part of me that I can't help, you know. I've long since distanced myself from that type of life, but it doesn't go away, right? It doesn't go away. I've prayed about it and whatever. It's not a problem to me anymore.
it's clearly not a problem to the Holy Spirit. So anyone's got a problem with it, it's not my problem, it's not the Holy Spirit's problem, right? So it's like, here we go, and it certainly keeps me abased, that's for sure, that we don't get exalted, that we share the sufferings of Jesus so we'll be glorified together. Which brings me also to this BitChute testimony I wanted to share. So every time I post on BitChute and the word Zion is in the title, it triggers them. There's a real problem on BitChute. I see on BitChute that it's a real playground for little hat hating, and it's everywhere. It's rife. So when you see that word Zion, when they see that word Zion, they instantly connect it to Satan, because that's what Zionism today is on the earth. Zionism is the religion of the little hats, and the religion of the little hats is Satan's religion. And that's why that country's called, I'll say Israel, that's why that country's called Israel, because they're Satan's people observing Satan's religion, right? Because Satan's a counterfeiter. Because Israel is God. Israel is the Lord Jesus Christ. Israel is actually God's people. So what else? What else would Satan use, right? But I see it's a real playground. It's a real playground for them. And I've seen this doctrine quite a lot. Quite a lot. He just left this comment. He left this comment and said, oh, this is the scourge of all humanity, right? This is the scourge of all humanity. And it gets wearying seeing comments like this, because I don't do these videos for, how do you say, I don't do them for, to be lifted up. I don't do them, adulation, that's the word. I don't do them for that at all. I do them so we can all learn together and that the brothers and sisters in the body of Christ get edification from them. So I'm not looking for adulation at all. But when you, each one of these videos, like that last Pick Park video I did, it was a mission, man. But the amount of hours I spent on that video, it must have been 30 to 40 hours I spent on that video. It was an absolute, absolute epic, you know, and you post it and people just, this is the scourge of all humanity, because all they're doing is looking at the title and that in ignorance, you know, and it gets hard, right? And I'll share this now, right? So this is interesting. I got this one yesterday in the little calendar. Actually, this is what I say. I've got myself muddled up. I forgot it. I'll put it up on screen. I got this one yesterday in the little calendar from Proverbs 13:12. I knew this had happened. I think I've got some sort of issue, right? So you're like, if it's 1 Timothy 2, I will always say 2 Timothy 1. And I do it constantly. And I go through my notes here and I look for the verse, and I can't find it. And then I go, no, I know what I've done. And I just instantly know what I've done. I go to 2 Timothy and there it is. It's just bizarre. Like the mistakes I make, I just laugh about it. And I think it's just all part of the sufferings and the infirmities, right? It's just things just constantly go wrong by my own doing, but also just things just constantly go wrong, right? But anyway, there's a little calendar yesterday. Proverbs 13:12, hope deferred maketh the heart sick, so weak. But when desire cometh, it is a tree of life. So I see that word desire as like a lust of the flesh. You desire the forbidden lust, right? But no, it's pertaining to when that hope, the desire being that hope, when it cometh, it is a tree of life. So it's just so interesting, because that's what I want to talk about today. Just suffering with the Lord Jesus Christ as we get glorified with him, right? And it gets hard for me, it does, when I get comments like that. It's fine, but when you like on BitChute, I'm at a point where you see that you've got a comment, you go, oh, here we go, it's either going to be abuse or it's going to be somebody just leaving a link to somebody else without even looking at my video so I can be a billboard for their Masonic lies, right? That's what BitChute tends to be. And it's a real playground. It's a real playground for little hat hating. It's just rife there, right? It's because you can't do it on YouTube, of course. And it's just absolutely rife. And it's a bit of a cesspit, BitChute, right? But this guy came through and I thought, okay, I've seen this before. I've seen this before and I thought, I might have a bit of a yarn to this bloke. I might see if I can get him talking, because this is a doctrine where they're saying that Jehovah is actually Satan. Now, for me, the scriptures, it does not stand up. The scriptures do not say this at all, because who's the Lord talking to in Job 1 and 2, for instance, right? And who's tempting the Lord Jesus Christ in Matthew 4? But anyway, it's Jehovah's glory, right? Jehovah's Lord Jesus Christ. Jehovah's the King of everything. Jehovah's the Creator of the world. But I thought, like the other day, I went up to Coles up here. Yeah, I'm not going doing a real good job of staying on track, am I? I went up to Coles up here the other day to go to the shop, and there's two Jehovah's Witnesses standing out the front. And I thought, I have a yarn to these people. I want to understand a few things. So I asked them about John 1:1. And the lady was hard, right? Oh, she was tough as nails, the lady. She was just like, oh, yes, yes. And the man, you could see, you could just by looking at him, he was completely brainwashed. And the woman, I said, John 1:1. She went, yes. And I said, in your Bible, it says the word was a lower G God. And she says, well, because he is. She was quite indignant, and just hard as nails, this woman. And I thought to myself, well, you're the one that's changed the Bible, right? You've changed the Bible, so I'm not going to make any assumptions about what you're talking about here. But I just wanted to get information. You know, I see this Jehovah's Witness religion. I see it as, it's very, very fascinating for me. And don't get me wrong, it's not alluring or anything like that. It's a religion of nonsense and brainwashing, and it seems to be a cult. But I see it's going to play a big role in the end times. I just feel it. It's going to play a significant role here. And it's just their belief system of nonsense just absolutely intrigues me. And I want to know more about it. And I asked, and she says, because he is a lower G God. And I said, who's the word? And she said, Jesus is the word. I said, so Jesus is a lower G God. And she said, yeah, he's in the heavens or something. I can't remember exactly what she said. And I just thought, okay, thanks for your time. And I just wanted to be on my best behavior, right? And I didn't want to cause a scene. And I wanted the Holy Spirit to be happy with my work. So I walked away. But I wanted to ask them again where... Next time I see them, I'm going to ask them about, well, is he on the same level as Michael and Gabriel? And if it's the Lord's will, I'll get another opportunity, right? But the guy chimed in and he said, I said, "Is Jesus, so Jesus isn't God?" And that she went, no. And the guy says, no, of course not. The Jesus talks to God all the way through the book of John. And I thought, and you could see he was just talking religion. He was just talking what he was taught. You could just see it, right? And I think this is what I'm talking about now, that, and this is part of the reason why I find them fascinating, because this is what I'm talking about now. And a big key to all this, for me, a big key to all this is that we know, and we love the truth that the Lord Jesus Christ is in fact God. As he and the Father are one, we become one in each other, and we become one in them, right? Now, if the Lord Jesus Christ is a lower G God, for me, you're missing the whole point. As I see that religion just come more and more focus in the end times. So it's interesting, right? It's interesting. So you get them talking and you can learn. And I'm going to start doing this. Not talking to people, talking at them, asking them questions so they can reveal themselves to me. It's a very good way to live. I've never been like this, but it's a very good way to live. I don't give nothing about myself away unless I'm asked, and I just want to know about other people and their belief systems and who they are. And it's just absolute, it's an intriguing way to live. And I only reveal myself to people when they ask, because for me, if it's the will of the Holy Spirit, they will ask. And for me, that's a big part of being led by the Spirit of God, is that the Holy Spirit will put that spirit in them where they're drawn and they're intrigued and they want to know more about me, right? As I say at the end of my last video, I count it an honor and a joy and a privilege and a blessing to be able to speak to people about the Lord Jesus Christ. It's not a work of your own hands, no way. they've got to be drawn, and the Holy Spirit has to put that spirit in them. And then we're being led by the Spirit of God, and we know it's a work of the Holy Spirit being wrought in us. Anyway, this BitChute guy, so he's got this doctrine, right? He's got this doctrine about Jehovah being Satan. And he claimed that he'd read the Bible in its entirety, and that was the conclusion he came to. So I find that straight away, I didn't say it to him, but I find it very, very suspect that you can read this whole book and actually think that Jehovah's Satan, because there's too many contradictions. But what he did raise was valid. He knew a couple of scriptures that really backed up, well, in his mind, it backed up what he was saying. Because this is the question I want to ask, right? So right through the Old Testament, we're getting innocent animals sacrificed, right, by the God of life. It's something that still makes no sense to me. The only sense it does make is a bit of a contradiction, right? It makes no sense, but this is the sense it does make. But the potential sense it makes is that sin is death. So in order for sin to be appeased for God, there has to be death. And that's what the Lord Jesus Christ did. He was the perfect sinless sacrifice, and he put away sin as he defeated death, right? I get that in part. The whole blood and all that, I'm still far from where I want to be and know I need to be. But I pray for these things, and when it's time, the Holy Spirit will reveal them to me. I'm confident of that. But it's a bloodbath, right, in that Old Testament. Now, I think there's more to consider here with it, because if you're, like, here in Australia in the middle of summer, if you're in the outback and you're just sprinkling blood everywhere and you're rolling kidneys out on the ground and you're sprinkling tables and candles and altars and all that, the flies would be absolutely horrific, and it'd just be a devastating scene of death. It leads me to think there's more to consider here, because God's glorious, right? Jehovah's glory. But he pointed to the story of Jephthah. Now, Jephthah, there's most certainly a burnt offering. He offered up his daughter as a burnt offering to the Lord. I don't see where the Lord required it, but for me, why did Jephthah want to do that? That for me is the big question. Why would Jephthah vow that if the Lord blesses him and he's with him, that he's going to offer up his daughter to be a burnt sacrifice? Why would he do that? Why wouldn't he just say, Lord, I've got confidence in you and I'm going to have faith in you, thus you don't require sacrifice, so you're going to deliver this enemy into my hand? But instead he offered his daughter up for a sacrifice, and it brought him low when she came out of the house, and she went and bewailed her virginity, and he carried out the burnt offering, right? The sacrifice. And this guy's very, very justified because of Jephthah in his mind. Very justified that Jehovah's actually Satan. And he's justified because he said to me, Christians hide behind and they hide behind faith. And they just explain it away and think that's acceptable, and this is just a heinous crime. And you think, I get where you're coming from, mate. I do, because I've got the same questions and concerns about the story of Jephthah and all of these burnt sacrifices. And you think, like, when you can't answer it, it's hard. Like, do you find that? It's really, really hard. It's like, well, how can your God be so glorious when he's killing sheep and goats and cattle and oxes just because of what? For what reason? And the fat's to be given to the Lord, but that fat can't be given to the Lord unless it's burning in the fire. I mean, if you get a hunk of fat and you burn it in the fire and you leave it there till morning, that fat's not there, right? But that's how the Lord receives it. There's more to consider. But in any case, it's like, This guy's justified by the story of Jephthah. And in Hebrew, he quoted Hebrews 11. He just happened to know that verse as well, right? That Jephthah's in the roll call of faith in Hebrews 11. He knew all of these scriptures, but he didn't. And I was asking him questions, but all he kept saying to me was just how evil and vile and Jephthah and all the rest of it. He wouldn't answer my questions about It's just what I want to know from these people now is that, okay, if Jehovah's Satan, who's he talking to in Job 1? Help me understand here. I want to understand these crazy belief systems and how people can actually fall for them, you know. The word of God being sown in people's hearts, but Satan stealing it away. So do you, like, I found, what my explanation was, mate, I don't know, but what I feel it could pertain to is I offered him some scriptures in the New Testament, and I saw one yesterday, it might have been the day before, that seems to almost pertain. Well, it's a sweet savour to the Lord. The body. So we read that in Romans 12. Offer your body to a sacrifice to the Lord. This is your reasonable service. And in, is it 1 Peter, it might be 2:7 or 1:7. Unless it's 2 Peter 2:7, this is the thing, right? Where it says that our bodies are a living sacrifice to the Lord. And I saw one yesterday, the day before, where it pertains to our sacrifice is a sweet smelling savour to the Lord. And when you put those two Hebrew words together, it's H5930 and H5927 or the like for memory. When you put those two words together, offered burnt offering, it pertains to ascension. It pertains to ascension and Solomon ascended to the house and all the rest of it. And it's also got that H word that upsets the little hat so much that they rammed down our throats, right? They rammed their lies and their beliefs down our throat. And I explained, that was potentially that's what this is. And he just lost it. He said, another Christian just hiding behind faith and trying to explain it away, you know? So I just found in the end that I've just justified this bloke. And it's really got to me, you know? Because one thing I do not want to do is justify people in their lies. So potentially I shouldn't have spoken to him, or maybe I shouldn't have just spoken about Jepner, I don't know. But I just wanted to, in the spirit of meekness and truth, and I thought I might try and help the guy out, but he just lost it. He just lost it, and he's lost this bloke. He's completely lost. It's very, very dark, and he ended the conversation, and I said, look, unless you can answer my questions, I've got no real interest in this conversation anymore. I want to do works that are pleasing to God. So unless you can answer my questions, or unless you can tell me more about what you actually believe in, what you don't believe in, I'm going to end this here. And then he just started hating on the little hats and saying that the little hat's God is actually Lucifer. And I'm like, well, yeah, that's pretty obvious, mate. We all know that. We all know that. And we all know in the Old Testament that the Jews forsook the Lord and they worship strange gods. We know that. And that's what I want to talk to you about. But I'm not going to write because it's just going round and round. But do you find that sometimes people come forward and they just ask you these legitimate questions that you just can't answer? Like, why? Why did Jepner offer his daughter to be a burnt offering? To me, that's what it looks like. That's what it looks like to me, is that he sacrificed his daughter to the Lord. Why would he do that? And why would the Lord accept that? It's hard, right? It's hard. Hope deferred maketh the heart sick. But when desire cometh, it is a tree of life, right? And it reminded me actually of the little calendar that I shared a few videos ago from Friday last week. And it came from Romans 8:18. I'm in Romans a lot at the moment, Romans 8:9-10. For I reckon the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. And this is what I want to talk about today, is just how our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. We suffer with him so we can be glorified together. What does that mean? What does that mean that we can be glorified? We can be glorified together as we become one in one another and one in God and Jesus who are one together. Now, I also want to share this calendar I got last week as it pertains. Yeah, I share this at the end of my last video, that's right. How it pertains to talking to people like this bloke, right? So 1 John 4:6, we are of God. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not us. Hereby we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. Like right through that conversation, I wanted to say to this bloke, I said it to him. I said, I know you're not going to understand, because the preaching of the cross to them that perish is foolishness, but unto us it is the gift of God. Well, it's everlasting life, right? And I said, I know you're going to reject this. I said, because you don't have faith and you've got no testimony. I said, but I know that this book is true because of what's been happening in my life over the last 6 years. And I wanted to say to him, I know what you're saying. I did. I basically did. I know what you're saying is not true. Well, how do you know? I just know, right? But it's not good enough. I know it's not good enough. I know it's not good enough because he's got legitimate concerns that I can't answer. But because we're of God, only they that know God hears us. And I think about my friend down at the shops, the owner of the shop, right? He hears me because I'm led to think he's of God. My mother hears me because she's of God, right? People that watch my videos, they hear me because you're of God, right? And I hear you, and I hear my mother, and I hear this guy down at the shops who owns the shop. We all hear each other because we're of God, right? And those that are not of God, they don't hear us. So thus, we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error, the knowledge of good and evil, right? And then I got, I'll go here now. And then I got this one just now in 1 Timothy 3:9. And it's speaking of the deacons, holding the mystery of the faith in a pure conscience. The mystery of the faith, right? The revelation of the mystery. And this is these are the scriptures I've been sharing in Romans 16. Now to him that is power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. But he's now, so the revelation of the mystery, but now he's made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations to the obedience of faith. And that's what we're getting in Timothy 3:9, holding the mystery of faith in pure conscience. Because those that are not of God, they're not going to understand, right? They're not going to understand. So we have to hold that because it's a mystery to them, as it was a mystery to us. And we have to hold that in a pure conscience to God, never using it for a cloak of malice or an occasion of the flesh. I just wanted to understand where this guy's coming from. Mate, I want to hear you. I want to hear you. But just anger. Just total and utter anger. Very, very settled in the truth. And I actually asked him, I've gone, so you say that Christians try to explain this away. I said, so are you saying that you're not open at all to any sort of discussion about this apart from what you are saying is true? And just doesn't answer. Just doesn't answer. But I'm glad I did it. I'm really, really glad I did it. But I did learn that it all stems from hatred of the little hats. That's where it all stems from. And that's a big part of it too. The little hats have to be hated so they can be the victim. It's a huge, huge deal that the perpetrators are the victim. And for me, that's why a lot of their evil works is just laid bare so they can actually play the victim. And they use the happenings in the 1930s, that great big hoax, so that they can play the victim. And anybody that stands against them, they're a member of the royal family, right? So yeah, I'm just thinking, I'm sort of 45 minutes in and I haven't even really started, but I'll keep going. So I'll start here today, back in 1 Timothy 3 and verse 16. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. right? So that says what it says. Now, my understanding, this has been my view pretty much since day one, but for a long time it was just a view. I wasn't confident enough in the scriptures that this was actually the case. But my view pretty much from day one was that it was just a feeling I had, was that what if God actually came in the flesh? God manifested as a fleshly man. What would that look like? To me, that would look like the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, a part of that that I used to think all the time, and I still do, is that now we can't say to God, you don't know what it's like, because he does know what it's like, because he lived as a carnal entity. He was in the likeness of flesh. We get that word likeness of the flesh of man. I'm being led to think he was in the same flesh as us. He most certainly came in the flesh. I'm not going to confess anything different, but we get that word like, and I'm not settled on it yet as to whether his flesh was better than ours or not. But no, I'm starting to see that word like actually means that he came in the flesh, right? The Lord Jesus Christ was in the flesh. So he was God manifest in the flesh, Emmanuel, God with us. So that's a big part of the Godhead, but it's also, to me, it puts it away. Like, I've heard people say, give me one verse that says that Jesus is God. It's 1 Timothy 3:16. And also, it's in Peter, the one I shared. I'll put it up on screen, in Peter, where it was the Spirit of Christ that the prophets were speaking. It's Isaiah 42:1 from memory, that says that the Lord's going to put his Spirit on him. And that's the Holy Spirit, which is the Spirit of Christ, which is the Spirit of Jehovah, right? Father, Son, Holy Spirit, they're all the same. Liquid water, gas water, and ice water. The same thing manifesting three different ways. So the Lord Jesus Christ is God, right? Now, I've been looking for a verse in Scripture so I can put this thought down about how Scripture should be read, right? So Jesus is God. I'm absolutely settled on that now. Jesus is God. Now, we come into 1 Thessalonians 1:3, not 2nd Brett, 1 Thessalonians 1:3. Remember without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God. And we get that word, and our Father. Now, when I read Scripture, I see that word "and" sometimes, and I think, is it pertaining to the same thing, or is it pertaining to something different? Because when I'm writing, if I use that word "and," it can mean either. It can mean either. So it's like the one thing has two different usages, or the one thing has two different names. So the Lord Jesus Christ and Emmanuel, potentially. It's pertaining to or Jehovah and Abba Father. It's the same thing, manifest two different ways, or it could pertain to two different things. So I've got my coffee and I've got my pencil, right? So I read that word "and," and I think, okay, in the sight of God and our Father. So it's the same thing, right? So God is the Father, but we get that word "and." God and the Father. It doesn't say God who is the Father. It doesn't say God the Father. It says God and the Father. So we get patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, God was made manifest in the flesh. And then we come into 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 2. Grace unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So you put them together, and we get in 1:3, our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. Grace and peace be unto you from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. So it leads me to think that whenever, it does say in the sight of God, but the Lord Jesus Christ is God, right? But I see, so how is the Lord Jesus Christ made manifest right now? What's the difference between the Lord Jesus Christ and his body? So there's a body of Christ in heaven, Michael, Gabriel, the holy angels, the body of Christ, the trumpets. They're all making up the body of Christ. Those in Revelation 12 who have overcome. The people in heaven in Revelation 19:1. There's another scripture in Revelation as well that pertains to the people in heaven. So that's the body of Christ. How is the Lord Jesus Christ different to the body of Christ? How does the Lord Jesus Christ actually manifest now? On the earth, the body of Christ. How is the body of Christ different to the Lord Jesus Christ? He sat down in the right hand of the Father, and he is the Father. They're one. And here he's in the sight of God. The sight of God. So how does the Lord Jesus Christ actually manifest now? Because he manifests different, because there's still a difference made in the sight of God our Father. But for me, this potentially, every time we read from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, it could be pertaining, it's just pertaining to God the Father, because the Lord Jesus Christ is now one with that, with the Father, as we become one in them, right? As we suffer in our infirmities, we rejoice in our infirmities because we remain abased as our lives become the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. But we don't know. We can't comprehend the sufferings of this present time of the glory that's going to be revealed in us, right? So then we consider 2 Thessalonians 2:16. Now our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God, even the Father, which hath loved us, have given us everlasting consolation and good hope through grace. So it's quite loaded, right? It's a very, very loaded verse indeed. But we've got our Lord Jesus Christ and God, even our Father. So we've got that word "and" again. So in 2 Thessalonians 1:2, we've got God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And in 1 Thessalonians 1:3, we've got hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. So God and our Father are the same thing. The Lord Jesus Christ and the Father, for me also, are the same thing. So we've got the Lord Jesus Christ in 2 Thessalonians 2:16, the Lord Jesus Christ himself and God, even our Father. So how's that different to 1 Thessalonians 1:3 as we take in God and our Father? We get that word "and our Father" and 2 Thessalonians 1:2 from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Is there any difference? Is it saying that God is actually the Lord Jesus Christ? Or is it saying we've got a tub and a pencil, we've got God and the Lord Jesus Christ? Or are we saying that that tub is actually, well, I won't say it like that, but the Lord Jesus Christ is actually God? But because the Lord Jesus Christ clearly now is God, look, when I say now, I mean as it pertains to what I'm understanding in those scriptures, the Lord Jesus Christ is God. So it becomes very, very interesting indeed. Now we take in this one. 1 Timothy 1:2, unto Timothy, my son, in the faith, grace, mercy, peace, from God our Father and Jesus Christ, our Lord. So we get that word Lord again, right? So we've got the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's how I always refer to the Lord Jesus Christ, as the Lord Jesus Christ. But in the Old Testament, Jehovah is most certainly referred to as the Lord. So we've got God the Father and Jesus Christ, our Lord. So is it the same as 1 Timothy 1:3, God and our Father? And we're getting the Father and Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the Lord in the Old Testament is actually God, right? So that word Lord is Greek word G2962. We get it a lot, and it's translated out as Lord, lowercase Lord, Master, Sir, and we get four miscellaneous. So as it pertains to the Lord Jesus Christ in this scripture, it's capital L, right? Capital L, the Lord Jesus Christ, capital L. So the outline of biblical usage, we get he to whom a person or thing belongs, about which he has power or deciding, Master Lord. So we could pertain that to the Lord Jesus Christ and Jehovah in the Old Testament. The possessor or disposer of a thing, the owner, one who has control of the person, the master. In the state, sovereign, prince. We get this word prince, right? I'm going to get to this in just a sec. Chief, the Roman emperor, is a title of honor expressive of respect or reverence which servants greet their master. This title is given to God, the Messiah. I can't see where they are just yet, but as I process this video, I'll look for them, and I'll pop it up on screen if I can find it. So it's now later in the day here. It's now about 4:30. It's the same day, and it's only about half an hour now to sundown. I thought it's been a big day, and I've read a few things today in the scriptures that pertain to this. And I thought this video is just going to change course. I think I'm already about an hour in, and there's quite a few more things that have come in this morning. So I'm going to push back what I was going to concentrate and focus on this video, and come down to the park and do another one. Come down to the park and do another video with those things. But I just want to finish this out, because there's a few more things here that I want to look at. And there's different bugs here in the afternoon. There's a lot of mozzies, and there's a lot of bugs that are very, very excited to see me. If only people were as excited to see me as bugs such as mozzies. But you look at this word Lord, and they're everywhere. You look at this word Lord, the Lord Jesus Christ, and it could pertain to every single one of them, of these meanings, and it probably would, but it's also the title given to God, the Messiah, right? I didn't notice that. So who's the Messiah? That's what Christ means. Christ means anointed. He's the Son of God, and he's the Messiah. And we need to believe on those things, that he's the anointed, he's the Son of God, and he's the Messiah. And this title is given to God who is the Messiah. And we read over and over again in the Old Testament that I am the Lord, there is none other like me, there is none other beside me. The Lord Jesus Christ, right? And the Lord God. So we come back now into these scriptures, and that's the thing. The Lord Jesus Christ and God, in the sight of God and our Father. Hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, in the sight of God and our Father. In the sight of God, he's sat down at the right hand of the Father. Now, consider this one in 1 Timothy 1:2. Unto Timothy, my own son in the faith, grace, mercy, peace, from God our Father and Jesus Christ, our Lord. So Jesus Christ, our Lord. So we've got the Lord Jesus Christ, but Jesus Christ is actually our Lord, because the Lord Jesus Christ is Messiah, and that's what we're getting in the Greek word. This title is given to God, the Messiah. And then I got this one in 1 Timothy 5:21. I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, and we get another end. And the elect angels. Now these elect angels are the holy angels. Angels are spirits. So for me here now, we're getting Father, God, the Lord Jesus Christ's Son, and the elect angels, which are the holy plural spirits. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Father, Son, the body of Christ, who is the Holy Spirit for me. And the Holy Spirit dwells in us, the body of Christ on earth, and we're the sons of God. there's something here, right? 1 Timothy 6:15. I'll pick it up at 12. Fight the good fight of faith, lay hold of eternal life, where thou art also called and have professed a good profession before many witnesses. Who are those witnesses, right? Are they the holy angels, the innumerable company of angels, the great multitude? Was it Revelation 7? Who are these many witnesses? Are we doing it? Are they people on the earth today? I'm not being led to think they even notice. They couldn't care less. I don't think it's that, unless they are actually witnessing something that they're not noticing, maybe. But because the Lord Jesus Christ, he talks about the holy angels. If you deny him, he'll deny you in front of the Father and the holy angels. But if you acknowledge him, he will acknowledge you to God and the holy angels. These holy angels are absolutely, absolutely significant. Fight the good fight of faith and lay hold an eternal life, whereunto thou art also called and have professed a good profession before many witnesses. I give thee charge in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things, and, we get that word "and" again, before Christ Jesus, who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession. Witness a good confession, right? So he was a perfect sin offering. That thou keep this commandment without spot. So the virgin, the chaste virgin to Christ in, is it 2 Corinthians 5 and the 144,000? They're not defiled with women, right? It's got nothing to do with your sex life. It's being without spot, to be unrebukable and without blemish. The outcome of the progression of faith unto the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. So God was made manifest in flesh, right? So that entity, the Lord Jesus Christ, he is still in some sort of form now, because he's sitting at the right hand of the Father, but him and the Father are one. It's just so hard to comprehend it. Now, get this in verse 15. Which in his times he shall show who is the blesseth and only
potentate,
King of kings and Lord of lords, right? So I've never looked at that word
potentate,
and I did this morning. I had a look at it this morning, and my, it just blew my mind. I don't know why. I've never looked at it before, because it's a strange looking word to me, and it's got a capital P, which for me pertains to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, he's the King of kings and he's the Lord of lords. Now, that word, of which I'm not going to try and say no way, it's Greek word G1413, and we only get it the three times. Mighty, right? Mighty and authority. And this time we get it in the scripture I'm sharing. So the other times we get it, it's very interesting. Luke 1:52, a scripture that I've been sharing a lot of recent. So he's put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. Now this for me are the unclean spirits in the kingdom who are being cast out. The old daughter of Zion in Lamentations 2. The seed of Ephraim in Isaiah 28. Potentially connected to Satan and his angels. Satan's got a seat, which is a throne. Lucifer's got a throne, which I'm being led to think is their mountain. Well, it seems to me that Lucifer's got a throne. Satan's going to give the seat, his seat, well, he's going to give a seat to the beast in Revelation 13, the seats. And the body of Christ are going to sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And that's what I'm seeing here. He's put down the mighty from their seats. And this is the same Greek word as describing the Lord Jesus Christ as
potentate,
this word that I can't say. But the outline of biblical usage, well, it's a prince. It's a prince, right? And the other time we get it is in Acts 8:27, where we've got these scriptures about the Ethiopian man who repented and got baptized, and we've got talk about a chariot, which for me is a celestial body, every single last time we read these scriptures. And he's a eunuch of great authority. So he's one of these, well, he's one of these mighty for me, but he's not being cast down from his seat. So I'm being led to think that he potentially has his own throne, and these are celestial scriptures. So where Philip's is here in Acts 8, it just absolutely blows my mind. But it's pertaining to a prince. It's pertaining to a prince, of course, right? So this now takes me back to Daniel 8 and verse 25. So this, just going on memories, talking about the rough goat, which I'm being led to think is the beast that's coming up out of the sea. And through his policy, he shall cause craft to prosper in his hand. So I just, for memory, these words, I'll pop them up on screen, but it pertains to deceit and treachery, which is most certainly going on today. And through his policy also, he shall cause craft to prosper in his hand. He shall magnify himself in his heart, and by peace shall destroy many. He shall also stand up against the prince of princes, and he shall be broken without hand. So it's talking about the same prince of princes, right? The same prince of princes that we're getting in 1 Timothy 6:15. And in his times he will show he's the blessed and only
potentate,
the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, which means prince, and the Lord Jesus Christ is being referred to as the H8269 prince of all the princes, the Son and the Holy Spirit. So we come back to this scripture in 1 Timothy 5:21. I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels, the Holy Spirits, right? So for me here, we're getting Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and the holy angels, for me, are these H8269 princes that have all got a throne that we're getting in Luke 1:52. He's pulled down the mighty from their seats. So all of the unclean spirits and the body of Christ, them of low degree, they're going to be exalted. And this is very, very, very hard to do down at the park. My, this is difficult. So this is H8269, right? So H8269, prince of princes, which is the same Hebrew word as Michael, the archangel, is a prince. So in Deuteronomy 10:17, for the Lord is your God, a God of gods and a Lord of lords, a great God. We get that word mighty, right? A mighty and terrible, which regardeth not persons, nor taketh reward. So God is a God of God and a Lord of lords. But we're getting the Lord Jesus Christ, that he's the King of Kings and the Lord of lords. So the Lord Jesus Christ is Messiah, and Jehovah is Messiah, and we're getting the Lord Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, but Jehovah is a God of gods and a Lord of Lords, and that's what I'm getting here in Deuteronomy 8:25, that the Lord Jesus Christ is actually a prince over the holy angels, which I'm being led to think are the gods. So the Lord Jesus Christ is a Lord of Lords, and he's also a God of gods, and he's a King of Kings. So now I ask the question, what's a king? What's a king? Are kings actually, are they sometimes gods? Because that's what I'm saying here. The Lord Jesus Christ is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Jehovah is the Lord of Lords. So that's the same. It's exactly the same. The Lord Jesus Christ is the Lord of Lords. The Jehovah's the Lord of Lords. Jehovah's the God of gods. The Lord Jesus Christ is the King of Kings. As he's being referred to as a prince in Daniel 8, he's the prince of all the princes, which is the same Hebrew word as Michael, who's an archangel, which is a Holy Spirit, which I'm being led to think could very well be a God. And we come back to the Jehovah's Witnesses. And they put the Lord Jesus Christ on that level, and we're all becoming one with the Lord Jesus Christ as he becomes one with the Father, we're the sons of God. And to me, we're going to become, well, it says it, we're going to be as the angels of God in heaven as we come into the innumerable company of angels in Mount Zion, God's throne, God's holy mountain, right? Colossians 1 and verse 12, giving thanks unto the Father, which has made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. So we're talking here about the Father. So he's given us, he's made us partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. So we're talking about the Father here, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. So it's the kingdom of the Son, and we're talking about the Father, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. So now we're talking about the Son. We're now talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. For by him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, powers, all things were created by him and for him. Now, I've got Hebrews 11:3 here, and that gives us, through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that things which were are seen were not made of things which do appear. So the word of God framed the creation. God created the heavens and the earth. And we also get, it's in a psalm for memory, that the Lord, Jehovah, he created the heavens and the earth. The word of God. So the Lord spoke and the heaven and the earth were created. So God created the heavens and the earth. Jehovah created the heavens and the earth. The word of God created the heavens and the earth. And we're getting here in Colossians 1, that the Lord Jesus Christ created the heavens and the earth. So what's the difference here, right? Because here we're talking about the Father and the Son. Now consider this one in Colossians 2:9. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So it's talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. So in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. So that word bodily, right? The body of Christ, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the sons of God, the joint heirs of the inheritance in light. And God, Jehovah, the word of God, and the Lord Jesus Christ are all credited with creating the heavens and the earth. So that word Godhead, it's deity, the state of being God, Godhead. And the word bodily, it's pertaining to the exalted spiritual body visible only to the inhabitants of heaven. So for me, that's the Old Testament body of Christ, and it's the outcome of the progression of faith for the body of Christ in the everlasting kingdom. Only visible to the inhabitants of heaven. So does that mean only those in heaven now can actually see who the spiritual body of Christ? They can only see the spiritual body of Christ on the earth now, or is it actually the outcome of the progression of faith? But it's very, very interesting indeed, because the fullness of the Godhead bodily, that on its own for me is pertaining to the body of Christ, and that's what it says with that Greek word for bodily, of the exalted spiritual body visible only to the inhabitants of heaven. So something very, very deep going on here now. So it's now the next day. It's now the 28th. It's a Thursday. It's around about 2 o'clock in the afternoon here on the New South Wales Central Coast. And yes, we've got a nice big fat chemtrail behind us as they bleat on here more and more about global change. But I'm going to talk about that more in just a sec. So it's very, very interesting, the calendar that I got today, because I quote Hebrews 1:1 a lot, right? But today I got Hebrews 1:1 and two, right at the moment that I'm putting down this video. So it's quite remarkable, right? So this video has just changed a little bit. Again, it's been an incredible video, this. The amount of times that it's just ebbed and flowed and changed. God at sundry times and in diverse manners spoke in times past unto the fathers by the prophets. So every single last time. He's done it in many different times, many different ways, many different forms, gradually, a little piece at a time. But every single last time, it was by a prophet. Hath in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, whom he also made the world. So we just read in Colossians that the Father has made us joint heirs to be the inheritance of the inheritance in light. But the Son, he's been appointed heir of all things, by whom he also made the worlds. So that tells me the Lord Jesus Christ made the worlds. I'm 50-50 on that. It's very interesting though. Plural worlds, right? Plural worlds, pre-existing beings. This world and the world to come. But I look at this here, and verse 1, right through the Old Testament, the prophets were moved by the Holy Ghost, the testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, all the way through. But now in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son. Now we've got the Holy Spirit dwelling within us, the gift, the Holy Spirit. But now it's the Son, but it's actually the Holy Spirit, the Comforter. Now, I want to keep going here in Hebrews because this is, I'm just a fever pitch, Hebrews 1 and 2 now. I've been a fever pitch for a while that Hebrews 1 and 2 is actually telling us that's why that word angel shows up so many times, because it's actually telling us that that's who delivered the gospel in the Old Testament. It was the prophets who were angels every single last time, who being in the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, right? So that tells me that God's being referred to here as a person. And upholding all things by the word of his power, right? The word of God. When he by himself had purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Being made so much better than the angels, he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than thee. For unto which of the angels said he at any time, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be my son. And again, he bringeth the first begotten into the world, he saith, and let all the angels of God worship him. And we get that in Nehemiah 9:6 and Luke 2:13, I've got here. And of the angels, he saith, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire? So that's very interesting indeed. The ministers a flame of fire. So that's how he was manifesting in Exodus, as the cloud and the fire. And the fire went before them and after them. And I see this, that we're getting angels are spirits, and those angel who are spirits are actually God's ministers. And we get that right through the Old Testament, that the Levites, who I'm being led to think absolutely were celestial bodies, they were the Lord's ministers. So of the angels, he saith, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire. But unto the Son, he saith, thy throne, O God. So this is really, really hard to get. But so he's talking to the Son. The Father's talking to the Son. So these are the words the Father says to the Son. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. So I read that on the surface, and it's telling me that God is actually referring to the Lord Jesus Christ as God. Is forever and ever a scepter of thy righteousness is the scepter of the kingdom. But get this, thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity, therefore God, even thy God, has anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. And thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thine hands. So to me, it seems to be going in and out. It seems to be just going in and out here about just who's who. So Father, Son, Holy Spirit, right? So we've got the Holy Spirit dwelling within us. That's the spirit of prophecy, the testimony of Jesus right through. But in these last days, the Father has spoken to us by the Son. And it's the Holy Spirit that's actually dwelling within us. So there's something deep going on here, and it's very, very difficult. It's very difficult to put it down at the park, but this is what I say, this has changed. This video has changed. And I still want to put down what I intended to put down at the start of this video. And I also want to do part two of my Zion video, and I also want to do a video on the Godhead. So there's quite a bit I want to do, and I'm not quite sure how I'm going to do it all yet. It's just wowee, right? Now, we'll come back to 2 Timothy 1. This is really interesting. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Be strong in the grace. So we have faith so that we can be saved by grace. That's what the Lord uses. That's what the Holy Spirit uses to save us. He saves us by faith. So we've got that faith so we can be saved by that grace. So how does that faith actually increase? That for me, it's my testimony that faith increases by testimony. And the harder the struggle, the more difficult the challenge, the more that testimony grows, the more that faith grows, and the more grace we receive. Thus, we're strong in grace, right? Because that's what these are the soldiers in Christ scriptures. And the things that thou heard of me among many witnesses. So we get that again. The same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. So it's just so interesting because this is what the whole two books of Timothy are about. It's about Timothy being a teacher. So who are the teachers today? Who are the teachers today? Because it's the Holy Spirit that's going to teach us and guide us into all truth. The Holy Spirit teaches us. Man doesn't teach us. Man can absolutely teach us, but it has to be by the will of the Holy Spirit. I'm not seeing these teachers on the earth today. All I'm seeing is harlots, and all I'm seeing is people that are claiming to have the testimony. So who are the teachers? For me, they're the higher entities guarding souls of men. That's who I'm fever pitched that Paul's talking to here. He's talking to Timothy, who's actually a Holy Spirit. To me, that's because otherwise, who are the teachers? Who are they, right? Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who he has chosen him to be a soldier. So that for me just goes into faith. That for me goes into the fear of the Lord, knowing that, having that reverence that he's in charge of everything, and that everything is his will, and everything that's happening in our life is due to his will. So we're not getting tied up with the actual challenge at the time so much. It's trying to understand what the will of the Lord actually is. And if a man also strive for masteries, yet he is not crowned, except he strive lawfully. So in the gospel of peace, love, and truth, with faith at the center. The husbandman that laboureth must be first partaker of the fruits. Now, this in verse 7 really hit me a couple of reads ago. Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all these things. And I feel as though I'm getting more and more understanding as the days pass by here, and we get that understanding by the testimony, by our testimony, that testimony being the word of God that's sown into our hearts. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel. So we get that again. We get Paul and my gospel again. We're back in Romans 16. We get it again. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery which has been kept secret since the world began, but is now made manifest and by the scriptures of the prophets, God at sundry times, the testimony of Jesus, according to the commandment of the everlasting God made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. So Paul's gospel, my gospel, the gospel that was delivered to Paul, the perfect gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, of the Holy Spirit, That gospel is the obedience of faith. So the gospel, the word of God, is faith. For me, that's what Paul's saying in both of these scriptures. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed of David was raised from the dead according to my gospel, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer, even unto bonds, but the word of God is not bound. So there it is there, right? So that for me now absolutely connects that the gospel is the word of God, which is the revelation of the mystery, which is to serve God by faith. So it was that all the way through, all the way through. I saw in Hebrews today, Hebrews 3, where I'm pretty well settled now that the land in the Old Testament is the body of Christ. Hebrews 3 seems to give that away. And what I'm saying, because I see a scripture, it might be in Romans for memory, that the promise was not by the law, but they were commanded in, and there's another one in Hebrews that talks about there's better promises than these. And I've always struggled with those two scriptures because they were commanded under the law in the Old Testament. They had to abide by that law. That was the command given down by the Lord God right through that Old Testament. But what I'm seeing is the same, is the land is the same. So the promise is the same because the promise was not the law. The promise was the land. And for me now, it's the same land. But what's changed is that in the Old Testament, the first entry, they went into that land under the law. But now in the everlasting covenant, the body of Christ enter into that land, the body of Christ, which is, we've been brought to it. It's the blessing. We're just the inhabitants. The body of Christ is the land. And the better promises is that we now do it by grace so that it can be by faith as we gather that testimony, the testimony of God, the testimony of Jesus, which is that spirit of prophecy, that we can serve him and thus we're strong in the grace of God, right? So that for me absolutely connects. It absolutely connects it all for me. That's what I'm saying now, all the way through, that the word of God was the gospel, and that gospel is to serve God by faith. And that's the righteousness of God being revealed in us. The just shall live by faith. And I can't believe it. I'm almost to the end here. Remarkable, right? Remarkable. There's a couple more here that I want to share. Well, one, and then I got a couple of calendar verses. So this is very interesting as well in 2 Timothy. And it talks about the progression of faith and even goes to the true nature of our reality. So verse 20, because we're talking about in a great house, there are only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and earth. So I see an earthen vessel, that's our body. That's our tabernacle, that we have the Holy Spirit dwelling within us, which is the gift, which is the gift that's within us. The Holy Spirit, we have that treasure in those earthen vessels. So I look at this and to me, well, okay, we've got vessels of earth, but we've also got vessels of wood and gold and silver. So I'm seeing, because some of them are honor and some of them are dishonor. So you can't just an ingot, a golden ingot, or just a chunk of wood. Like that can't be honor or dishonor. It's got to have life, right? So that for me is a real insight out to read the Old Testament, that we've got gold, silver, and wood in the Old Testament that actually have life. And as I say those words, it reminds me of a scripture in Leviticus: the earthen vessel, gold, silver, wood, and sack for the and the like. Now in verse 21, if a man therefore purge himself from these, so that leads me to think the vessels of dishonor, he shall then be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use and prepared unto every good work. Now flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness. So the lusts of the flesh. So for me, being deceived, it's deceiving, lying, anything that turns you away from God, pride, envy, all of those character traits of the serpent in Galatians 5. Flee also youthful lusts, but follow after righteousness, faith, charity, peace. So the unclean spirits move out, the Holy Spirits move in with them that call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. So they call, right? Do people actually have a choice in this? Being led to think yes at the moment. But the Lord knows the hearts, right? Now get this. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they gender strifes. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach and patient. It's interesting, right? We get that word teach again. In meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure, perhaps, will give them repentance to the acknowledgement of the truth. So it's just so interesting. In meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. So I think about that fella on beat shoot. If God perhaps will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. So God gives them repentance, and the words we speak, the conversations we have, can absolutely play a role in that. Talk about how to wake people up, right? Walking in the gospel of peace, love, and truth, serving God in faith, in reverence, and in fear, but God can actually give people repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. It's a gift from God, right? Repentance. It is amazing. But get this, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. So that tells me if you don't have the Holy Spirit within you, Satan's just absolutely got you. He's just running absolute roughshod over you. If you haven't got the Holy Spirit, he's just got it. Away he goes. He's just got full authority. So you think about the Lord and Job, and Satan's just got that all the time. So it tells me now that before we were redeemed into the body of Christ, well, before all this started for us, that Satan was just completely ruling our lives. And I think back now to, is it 1 Corinthians 6? It's probably 2nd now that I've said that. But Paul says that we are the house of God and we're not our own. And he makes the connection between the body of Christ and the body of the harlot. Being translated into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ, or being translated into the image of the beast, right? The tabernacle of Molech. Thy fathers had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness, but instead they made the image of the beast in the Old Testament. I just see that also as a prophecy. But we all serve somebody, and if you don't serve God, if you don't repent, and you don't believe in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and serve God in reverence and fear and by faith, then Satan's just got you. He's absolutely got you. Which brings me to this photo, actually. So this fella's the leader of the Greens Party. So the Greens Party here in Australia are just the loopy left. They're mad. They're absolutely stark raving mad, the Greens. And they're just total hypocrites. They just want everybody just to be just total green energy. No pollution whatsoever. We don't serve the earth. The earth serves us, right? Totally, totally against what the scriptures say. The earth is here for the man. We're to look after it, but we're not serving it. But the Greens want mankind to serve the earth. And you look at it and you would think this guy in his office, I wouldn't have thought he's got all green energy in his office. He wouldn't have all green energy with his car. Even these electric cars, they all need to be powered by electricity. Where does that electricity actually come from? And I bet the clothes on his back, the production of those has some sort of footprint. They're just hypocrites, right? Hypocrites. Now, here in Australia at the moment, they are pushing global change hard. They've just released the economic figures here. And it's something like they've actually telling us that it's like 7-8% or something. It's just crazy. And you've actually got the treasurer here in Australia. He's actually telling us, as we see a chemtrail up there, they keep smashing us hard here on the New South Wales Central Coast right now. They keep smashing us with these chemtrails. But you've actually got the treasurer here right now. He's telling us that it's going to get worse. It's dire and it's going to get worse. I have never, ever seen a treasurer ever who tells us that it's going to get worse. They always spin it. They always give a positive outlook. They always give it an outlook which isn't realistic, that's not going to happen. And if you can see that over there,
there's actually a plane spraying. It's just amazing, right? They are absolutely right now smashing us with chemtrails. It's just crazy. As they talk about global change, right? It's just crazy. Like, that is all just a chemtrail.
But in any case, we've got the treasurer right now. He's telling us just how gloomy it's going to get, and it's going to get even worse. So they're being very, very open about it, which tells me it's going to get even worse than worse. It's going to get bad, and it's going to get really, really rough here. Now, all they want to talk about is global change. That's it. They're just not interested. They're not interested in fixing, helping people serve their money that they demand people to serve. Their priority is just this global change. And it's all just a fantasy. It's all just we all know that it's just a hoax, even though the Nahustans declared that it's a purple dragon. So I'm really in perilous waters there. But it's just remarkable, right? And you look at this photo, this is the leader of the Greens, who if he had his way, and we'd all be like the Flintstones, right? And he's holding up the 666, so there it is there, right? So you've got the football game on tonight, and the Manly coach, of course, he's throwing out these Masonic hand signs. The football game's on tonight, and it's just getting really, really dark. I'm keeping a keen eye on the agenda here, and what I tend to do and what I like to do is I read the comments. I have a look at a news article and I have a bit of a read of the comments. And these seven players now, they're being heralded as heroes for standing up for what they believe in, right? And I tend to agree with that. I think it's fantastic. It's just, well, no, we're not going to wear it. We're not going to wear this top because it goes against our religious beliefs and our cultural values. More power to them, right? But what I'm seeing now is an absolute division starting to emerge here between religion and this LGBTQ, whatever it is, agenda, right? The rainbow people. I'm seeing this, the scene is set. The scene is set here, and the amount of groundswell of support that's now going behind these players, it's going to get rough for me, man. It's going to get rough for me. What I can see happening now is I'm seeing there a lot of people that hate, ignorantly, they always connect being gay with kitty fiddling, right? They always say that a lot of people do that, and I've never quite understood it because the government out keeping somebody safe. That's fantastic. It's a 50 zone up there. So I'd say somebody's probably doing 55 or so. So we must keep them safe. But in any case, because that's what the government do. That's what they got them. All's good now. So they pay the government money and everyone's now safe. So phew, right? We could all breathe a sigh of relief. But what I'm seeing is I've been seeing it for a long, long time. And you look at the apparent leader of the US, and he's got a for both male and female, right? It's not just people that are like that. They don't just like, no, they, whatever, right? Whatever. Some like, whatever, right? But the two things are not connected at all. But what I'm starting to see emerge now is as they normalize that behavior, what they're doing that with the trans, with the whole trans thing, trans drag queens going into classrooms, etc. And I saw a video the other day of a trans teacher who's been teaching her first grade students about being transgender and her coming out story. And she's having children who are about 6 years old coming out to her, and they're just gleefully accepting this from these children. So now that child is now transgender, right? And they're 6 years of age. And I can tell you from a surety that I had absolutely no idea about this when I was 6 years of age, right? Now, they're normalizing it. They're normalizing the sexualization of children, and they're using the transgender and this rainbow community as their pawns in their games. Now, it's not a choice. If it was a choice, I would never have chosen this choice. It ain't no choice. It's something I've never wanted, and it's something that I absolutely detest to this day. But there it is. There's nothing I can do about it. And it's made my life hard. It's made my life bitterly hard my whole life. So it's not a choice, right? Now, what I can start, but they, people that hate, particularly people who profess the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, they just hate and hate and hate ignorantly. They've got no idea what's going on. They reject testimony, and they insist and they blather that it's a choice. It ain't a choice. Like, nobody in their right mind would do that, and nobody's got the ability to do that. How can you just wake up one day and just switch? I mean, it's just ridiculous, right? That's what it is, because that's how people, they make sense of it, I guess, and they're sweet in that area. They're sweet in that area, so it's very easy to condemn others who have got an affliction that ain't it, because they're perfect, right? They don't have to deal with it, so then they put themselves on their high horse. But that's the big thing that I see, particularly people who profess the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who claim to be Christians. They claim that it's a choice, right? It's a choice. Now, that's what I see what they're doing now with the sexualization of children. As they normalize that behavior, they're going to normalize it by saying that people are born with it, right? And you're going to have one side over here going, you're all cracked in the head. You're all cracked in the head. You're all sick. Everybody's going to be lumped into the same category, and everybody has chosen it. And that's where I can see where it's going. And that's what I can see what this agenda is with this Manly football jumper. For me, it's glaringly obvious now what they're doing, and it's just sick. And for me now, all I've got is my faith. All I've got is my faith. This is going to be very, very difficult indeed. As I reflect on 2 Timothy 2, that a good soldier of Christ doesn't get caught up in the wars. It doesn't get caught up in the wars of this life, right? It's going to get difficult for me, and I'm going to have to be really, really strong, just mentally. Just mentally, because I'm going to see attacks, and it gets hard. You see attacks, you see the agenda happening, and it's just going to get harder and harder and harder. But what do, right? Just cling to the Lord Jesus Christ and cling to our faith. Now, something else has come in too, just about, check this out, right? Something I said on a video the other day, that it may have been this one, that ties in with something that I was talking about probably about 12 months ago now, maybe not that long. But I see here on the earth, everything's temporal, right? We know that, everything's temporal. And you pay $1,000 today, and everything's sweet for about a week. You've paid your rent, you've paid all your bills, you don't need the system, everything's good. You can stop working if you want. You've got that $1,000, everything's good. But you need another $1,000 for next year, for next week, right? So when I was first starting to wake up, I used to hear them say that we're in a time prison. The earth is actually a time prison. Now, I see money in the scriptures. Money is actually a man's worth, a man's wealth. So in the current day, our value is determined on how much grace we're given and the abilities that the Holy Spirit give us. They can be our natural talents that we've been born with, but also the amount of faith that we're given, the amount of testimony that we're blessed with, and the amount of grace that the Holy Spirit affords us. And I see that grace as money, the great money belt in the sky, the dews of heaven, right? Now, I said the other day that I'm seeing it more and more now, that
every time I'm blessed, it's temporal. It doesn't last. You need more blessings. It buys you time, right? Time is money. I'm seeing it more and more again, and it has to be like that for me, because if it's permanent, you're not going to have a increased testimony due to that thing. It has to be ongoing, and we have to have these challenges. We have to keep having these challenges in our life, in our testimony, so our testimony can grow, so that our faith can grow, so that the Holy Spirit can give us more grace, so the Holy Spirit can give us more wealth. Time is money, right? So the Lord God, I'm seeing now that the Lord, he's buying us time. He continues to buy us time, because that's what money is. Money's time. Money's time in the on the earth, and it's also the grace of heaven. The dues of heaven, right? It's also the grace that the Holy Spirit gives us. Amazing, right? For me, it's all just become quite clear. So I'll finish out. I've actually got to the end of this remark. I'm going to finish out with this one that I got in the little calendar yesterday. Nahum 1:7, the Lord is good, right? A stronghold. So for me, a stronghold, we get it in Corinthians. A stronghold is somebody's belief system. So our stronghold is Zion, right? The city that can never be removed, God's throne. So the Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knoweth them that trust in him. How about that, right? As we reflect on 2 Timothy 2, those who don't trust in the Lord, those who don't believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, to me, they're just owned by Satan, and Satan's just running roughshod. He's just running roughshod over all of them, and we that trust in the Lord, our stronghold, well, we're going to be safe as our testimony grows, right? The Word of God. The Word of God, I'm a fever pitch now, that's what we're looking at. The Word of God is testimony, and the Word of God is the gospel, which is faith. And it has been all the way through. What a remarkable, remarkable thing. So I don't know what I'm doing next, I'm not sure. It's probably by the time I get this one up, it'll be Saturday again, so it might be hard to do a park video. But I'll just wait and see how everything pans out, because there's a whole heap I still want to do. See how this one pans out, see if we'll just see how things go. I do not know at this point. There's a million things I want to talk about, and every single day in those scriptures, it just gets more and more intense. I just keep seeing more and more. I just keep growing and growing and growing, and it's just magnifying now. It's just a wonderful, wonderful thing. Anybody that's got anything out of this video, it's been a different one. I've never come down to the park three times to do a park video, you know. It's been different because it's just kept changing. But I'm glad, I hope, and pray it's made some semblance of sense. Sometimes when these things come in, it's raw. Most of the time, probably all the time, something new comes in, it's quite raw. And it's hard to put down. But this is just how I learn, and I feel as though there's brothers and sisters out there that are learning with me. And if anybody's got anything out, and that's the biggest blessing of all for me, is that we just all learn together, and it's just my way. It's my office. I've just had another testimony today. Something remarkable has happened again today that's just increased my faith, and it's just increased my confidence that this is my office for now. This is what the Holy Spirit wants me to do. He wants me in that book every day. He wants me doing videos, and he just wants me to gather in testimony so that his glory can be made manifest in me. I'm quite sure of it at the moment. It's just incredible, right? It's just amazing. The testimony just continues to grow. Our testimony, right? The Word of God, the gospel, faith, the righteousness of God's being revealed. And it was that all along. Since the foundation of the earth. It's just a remarkable thing. Anybody that's got anything out of this, from the bottom of my heart, I do thank you. I do thank you for that, because that for me is a blessing. If you get something out of this, that for me is the best blessing I can have of doing these videos. Anybody that has watched, I do thank you. And it means the world to me to have brothers and sisters out there that are sharing their walk with me and choose to take up my offer to share my walk with me. And I've rabbited on too long.
and that's it, right? That's me. So from an absolutely sparkling and gleaming late winter's afternoon here on the New South Wales Central Coast, that is me, and all the power and all the glory goes to the Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Woo! Ho-ho, the King!
Heaven and earth will disappear, but my words remain forever. But no one knows the date now when the end will be, not even the angels, no, nor even God's Son. Only the Father knows. The world will be at ease, banquets and parties and weddings, just as it was in Noah's time before the sudden coming of the flood. People wouldn't believe what was going to happen until the flood actually arrived and took them all away. So shall my coming be. Two men will be working together in the field, and one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be going about their household tasks, one will be taken, the other left. So be prepared, for you don't know what day your Lord is coming.
Life was filled with guns and war, and everyone got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. Children died, the days grew cold. A piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come, you've been left behind.
Come, you've been left behind.